I'm Chris Gobber, welcome to my channel. And today I'm going to do a review slash analysis of a classic film and novel, in many respects perhaps the quintessential novel of dystopian fiction. That is George Orwell's 1984. I'm going to be reviewing the film version starring John Hurt and analysing that in reference to how well it matches Orwell's original classic dystopian fiction novel. And I'll just talk about, give some of my own thoughts on how well the film captures the original spirit, which is a very oppressed, deeply oppressive, probably the most, one of the most darkest visions of a future. And yeah, I'll just do that basically. Theorise, talk about that. So, 1984, the film version, starring John Hurt, is a very stark and grim vision of the future, in keeping in line with Orwell's original totalitarian vision of the future that he wrote in 1984, which was his final novel, written not long before he died of, I think it was tuberculosis or something lung related anyway. But,
By the time Orwell married Sonia Brownell, 1984 was written, after which he would never leave his bed again. But he left one final warning.
1984 is, I believe, a quite terrifying masterpiece. So terrifying, in fact, I don't think I should like to read another like it.
I am not absolutely dissatisfied with it. I think it is a good idea, but the execution would have been better if I had not been under the influence of TB when I wrote it.
You once claimed that you have an ability to face unpleasant facts. Is that what you've demonstrated in 1984 by drawing an accurate portrait of the future?
I think that allowing for the book being, after all, a parody, something like 1984 could actually happen. This is the direction the world is going in at the present time. In our world, there will be no emotions except fear, rage, triumph and self-abasement. The sex instinct will be eradicated. We shall abolish the orgasm. There will be no loyalty except loyalty to the party. But always, there will be the intoxication of power. Always, at every moment, there will be the thrill of victory, the sensation of trampling on an enemy who is helpless. If you want a picture of the future, imagine a boot stamping on a human face forever. The moral to be drawn from this dangerous nightmare situation is a simple one. Don't let it happen. It depends on you.
So it stars John Hurt, who plays Winston Smith. Winston Smith, in both the book and the novel, is the main character, the protagonist. He is a worker in the Outer Party. So within 1984, you have the idea is that this is supposed to be a classless society, but it's very strictly hierarchical. Everything is paradoxical, including their use of language. They have this new lexicon called double speak, double, and there's like this whole thing of double think. They're trying to create a new language, which is basically reducing the amount of words that you can use to describe anything, really. So, and 1984 explores this brilliantly, both in the book and in the film, how a hierarchical, totalitarian state can rewrite history as it wishes. That's the theme of the book. And Winston Smith is a man of the outer party. He's essentially a bureaucrat who works for the state. So you have the proles, who are just like your everyday normal people who are in extreme poverty. The outer party, who are essentially the middle class, and then a very small group called the inner party, who are an elite. And at the top of all this hierarchy, you have Big Brother, who is the Stalin-esque type figure, who is a icon, or it's called a personality around this man, who may or may not be alive. Of course, I'll give it at this point, I should say, spoiler warnings for both the novel and the film. So there's also, of course, Julia. So and there's recently actually just been a feminist retelling of 1984, which focuses more on Julia's perspective. Julia is another member of the outer party. She's a bit younger than Winston. She's on the surface ideologically possessed, you know, she's full of zeal, but again, this hides a rebellious spirit.
And I've got a loaf of bread, proper white bread, and jam, a real tin of milk. In a party, half a kilo.
How did you manage to get hold of all this?
Oh, there's nothing those bastards don't have. Aren't you pleased?
Yes. Yes, of course. A little tea.
There's been a lot of tea about lately. They've captured India or something.
I want you.
I want you to. Wait. Turn around and don't look until I tell you.
Listen to that. How can she make a song written by a machine sound so beautiful?
You can turn around now. Do you like me?
If you will. And as the story progresses, we find out that both Winston and Julia are extremely dissatisfied and alienated from the repressive and totalitarian society that they live in. Anyway, onwards to the film. I mean, that's just a summary of the story. The film itself is the cinematography, so I'm going to go on to analyze a few different things. In terms of how well it follows the original book, which I've read about 2 years ago, it's actually fairly accurate in terms of like how close it is to the original source material. And the way that the cinematography is stark. I mean, it's like brutalist ruins and everything else. You get a feeling of oppression. It's washed out, it's blue, it's grey. There's almost no real light of redeeming quality in the light in the film. Apart from when Juliet and Winston actually escape from the like deeply surveilled city environment where they live, right? And they go out into nature. So in some respects, you could argue that, maybe Orwell had this in mind, I'm not sure. I'm not like a, I'm sort of a scholar of Orwell, but I'm not like a hardcore one. It's a hobby, really. But yeah, well, there is, you could argue that there's a sort of return to nature romanticism and somewhat in the narrative, like if Julia and Winston are trying to return back to that, the ideals of, emancipatory ideas, which is, a lot of which comes from romanticism in some respects, right? The idea that humans should have liberty, the freedom to say what they want. Liberal ideals, actually, in a lot of ways, classical liberal ideals of the freedom to gather, the freedom to question power, the freedom to, which in Orwell's Big Brother Society is something that nobody has. And everybody's controlled, everyone has thought, everyone, there's like the thought police, they're known as. So everybody sort of surveys everybody else. Everybody's constantly spying on everybody else for any sign of ideological impurity. That's why it's such a nightmarish vision of the future. There's no escaping it. There's no escaping the eyes of the thought police, because everybody is a thought policeman, obviously. So everyone is so ideologically brainwashed, and they start it with children, that there is no way to escape this oppressive cloud. The cloud's everything, right? The thought police are everywhere, and every your neighbours are the thought police. Which is what gives Orwell's 1984 its oppressive quality in many respects. There is no escaping it. And obviously, spoiler alert here. When you actually read the book and the story, the conclusion of all this is actually that Big Brother wins, right? That Winston and Julia end up ratting on each other, in quite intended, in the film, you know what I mean? And...
Do you know where you are, Winston? I don't know. Do you know how long you've been here? No. Weeks? Months? Do you know why you're here?
Just sort of like giving in to the fact that 2 + 2 = 5, if the party says it equals 5, because they rule with fear and they rule with this pervasive, iron fist. And a lot of the story is all about as well how propaganda is used by the state to control the flow of information, and then how obviously it's used to promote fear, and how fear is then used to control the populace, but how there's no escaping from it because the members of the inner party are so ideologically brainwashed, they've convinced themselves they're in it. As though Brian, who's the one of the main figures also in the book, who Winston thinks of at first as he sees him and he thinks he's like a member of the inner party who is perhaps attached to the resistance movement, which centres around the figure Emmanuel Goldstein. Now, Emmanuel Goldstein, this has been well covered, is obviously influenced by Leon Trotsky. And the whole story, this is well documented, is a fictional retelling of the Marxist-Leninist, Stalinist variant of that. Right? Stalinism was extremely repressive. Show trials. Stalin himself was constantly paranoid about the enemy within. So, purges, gulags. And obviously, Stalin lost in the power struggle. No, won, sorry, in the power struggle with Trotsky. After Lenin was died, and that's where the Soviet Union really became an oppressive totalitarian regime. And Orwell was a man of the left. He was He'd fought in the Spanish Civil War against the fascists, and he was very acutely aware of the power struggles there within the left. He fought for a Trotskyist unit at first during the Spanish Civil War, but he noted there were like power struggles within the left as well, which often, you know, it's like left is eating itself sort of thing. But he was one of the writers who really did, in a lot of ways, was brave enough to question the Stalinist sort of narrative, which at the time was the prevailing sort of, like, because it became very centralized. It had, you know, the party line from the Communist Party, which had all become very centralized. And you know, a lot of leftists, a lot of writers went along with it as well, who were, like, you know, fellow travelers and such. Durante is a good example of that, like New York Times journalist, I believe, who just basically went along with it, like, you know, became a propaganda puppet, really, for the Soviet regime. But anyway, going off track a bit there. This is obviously a film that's worth watching. John Hurt's performance is quite understated. He plays a very quiet, introverted Winston Smith, which makes sense because in the book, he's very much a character who's internalizing and questioning everything. But obviously, he has to keep it secret. He has a secret journal that he keeps, you know, letters from a dead man and all that, because he knows if this ever gets found, he is dead, because he's questioning and actually recording down his rebellion against the system, which he sees all around him crumbling, but he has to pretend that it's not. And of course, as in the novel, as in the film, Julia is a pivotal character in the film, because she is also, like, she's the female equivalent of Winston, really, in a lot of respects. She's also rebelling, and she sort of orchestrates it with they can meet, and she sort of like does that in secret in a lot of ways, basically. And they fall in love, of course. She's like also, in a lot of respects, you could say Winston and Julia are both protagonists in the film. They're both key protagonists in the film. And they do, I was just saying hello to my mum, she's going for a walk with the dog. That's what I was doing, just thinking that. Weird, just walking the dog out the window. And yeah, and as a pair, they're obviously able to, you could say they're representing the male and female rebellion, I suppose, but that's academic, really. But yeah, this film's definitely worth watching. Obviously, I've been playing slicing clips as I'm talking through this, but the film version actually, like I said, captures the novel very accurately. The whole feeling of the novel is, it's when you read the novel, it's very much like it's an awakening in some respects, but it's not a pleasant awakening. It's an awakening to the fact that even power that might claim to be operating on your behalf to make a better world, a utopian world, a, you know, a paradise on earth, as, you know, the Stalinists and the Soviet Union did back in the day, they had this pure goal, if you will, the end, and they could justify it. Marxist-Leninists and Stalinists of that vein could justify it, because they had this whole idea of history will reach an end point when we reach communism, like full communism. But to get there, we do have to have like a workers' dictatorship for, I don't know, however long it takes, which obviously just means that they get stuck in stasis at that point, because human beings are human beings. Power corrupts, and, you know, it just becomes a self-defeating murderous cycle. Now, I'm not saying this because I recognise the left as a broad church, you know, but Stalinism was definitely rooted in just a bunch of obviously wrong premises, right? Like, you know, that you have this transitional stage where you have a dictatorship of the proletariat, which is just the inner party. I mean, it's just becoming corruption. And then, you know, there are corrupt people in any organisation. Sociopaths, actually, in a lot of respects. Stalin probably was one, right? Psychopath, whatever, sociopath. But these people assume power, and then obviously when they've got power, are they going to just let go of it? I mean, this is sort of the point I think Orwell was making in 1984, is that as soon as you have a clique within a supposedly emancipatory movement, you are going to get corruption. And obviously if you're in a dictatorship of the proletariat, or dictatorship in general, or totalitarian society, it's going to take a lot more to shift the balance of that power back to a democratic base, right? Now, Orwell was a democratic socialist, so that's how he self-identified. And as I said, he was a man of the left. He's a man of letters of the left. He's written many, many books, Homage to Catalonia, Why I Write, Down and Out in Paris and London. He's written a lot of work, you know, a lot of his theory as well, and his essays go into the left-wing politics of the time. And he wrote brilliantly, actually, and eloquently on the Stalinist repressions and about how intellectuals, unfortunately, latched onto that and supported what was a totalitarian regime. No, of course, 1984 is very important for that reason. As a story, it functions, but also as a historical critique of the authoritarian left, which still has it, its ghost still lingers in some respect in the imagination, even though the ideology is dead. Most people, very few people, would consider themselves Marxist Leninists unless they're on the extreme end of politics. You know, it's like a dead ideology in the same way as Nazism is dead. You get a few extremists who still believe in it, but overall it's a dead end, and people recognise that front foot. Anyway, it's obviously a bit of a mixed analysis, but you can probably find it online still, John Hurt and 1984 and everything. It's worth watching. I think everybody should watch it at least once. It's obviously quite a depressing film, but again, it's an important film to watch, I think, as a warning, you know. Anyway, leave it at that.